saying we get started. Yeah, we have a small crowd, but so we can discuss much more intensive, so that's nice. It's nice that you're here. I'm going to talk today about the software engineering initiative of DLR. And I'll shortly present to you what it is about, why we're doing this, in which context we especially are doing this, so the context of German Aerospace Center, and we want to discuss with you a bit about how this could be reused, what's perhaps missing, or if you have any feedback or so far, because this is fairly new. And we are just introducing this everywhere, and so we are eager to learn from others, but also that others can learn from what we already did. So my name is Karina Hoff, this is Tobias Schlaf, my colleague, we're both working on this project. We're both from the German Aerospace Center. And I want to start with, great, switching here but not there.
Okay, let's try this again.
Perhaps do I have to go here once? Ah, now it works. Nice.
Okay.
So, first, what's the German Aerospace Center about? We are a research organization paid by the government. We have more than 8,000 employees located on 20 different locations in about 40 different institutes and facilities. As you can see, it's distributed all over Germany. And we are not only on different locations, but we are also working on very different fields. So we are focusing on space, on avionics, on transportation, energy, safety, digitalization, and so on. So the top four are the main focus on this. But the one thing all of us have in common is that nearly everywhere we write code. I mean, the nature of research is that you need code. You need software for nearly all the research you perform. And so everybody writes code. And this is making DLR one of the biggest software houses in all of Germany, because not a lot of people have so many people developing. In 2005, which is quite some time ago, we did a survey and asked like how many percentage of the people working for us or how much of the time spent on software development, and we figured out that about 25% of the people working at DLR spending the time on software development, which means it's not just 25% of the people working there, but even more, because most people are not working full time, and 100% also management and stuff is included. Yes.
Can I ask questions?
Sure. Yeah. If you have any questions, for understanding, definitely.
So there's 25%. Maybe you're going to come to this. So those 25% who are developing software, did you ask how much of their time they're spending developing software?
So in the survey we asked, yeah, it's depending. We have nearly no people who do it full-time. Most of them do it like half-time or something in between. It's hard for them to give a real number because it really depends on which project they currently are and which stage of a project. But it's often between 25 and 50%, I would say. We didn't have... But it's numbers which are 13 years old. We knew that some, we had one institute who said they don't develop software at all, but we know they do. So it's kind of, we don't know why they weren't really honest with us.
Hard to get really hard data, because sometimes we are, we need to do some formal stuff and some real hard methods and things like that. So as usual, this is not so simple in such a distributed research organization to find all of the data that you would love to have about your community, because the more accurate data you have, the more you can also target your things that you want to, to find out what you want.
So most people have something to do. It also differs, like we ask, like if they have anything to do with software development. This could be also mean in a management way, not like developing software. But one thing which most of our developers have in common and which will make us different from most of the normal software houses is that most of our developers have no training in software engineering. So in the best case, they've probably had a programming class at university, or they had they are free trained, so they're just interested, so they're self-trained. So they just looked stuff up and learned it on the way. And that's the first thing I want to ask about how it's a new development. So is it similar? Do you also have people who are mainly developing who are not developers? Or is it focus to, so I started about giving hand signs, perhaps so can do this even with just six people.
Yeah.
So where do you say, okay, we have most people who develop code are also not really trained for that. Hands up. Okay.
Well,
yeah, we had the software survey that the SSI ran, and it found that majority of people who
okay.
developed in software didn't have formal training.
Okay. So, and somebody having where it's perhaps separated, because I heard from some organizations where you have really like RSE who do all the coding, and you have those scientists who have more or less just gives you introductions. Somebody coming from such an organization?
So,
you
want the distinction?
We
have RSEs?
So, RSEs and scientists. And the scientists nearly don't know coding. So, I heard from that, but.
So, I think
it's a bit of a nuanced environment because RSEs are just. Started in the last four
yeah.
or 5 years,
yeah.
and you sometimes had an embedded software developer or a postdoc doing the.
Okay, but you had specific persons not often doing the software development, not like everybody.
Yeah, it depends on how in the career you are.
Yeah.
Okay.
All I was going to say, there's a lot of change happening.
Yeah.
A lot of. It's not homogenous. It's very different in different places. Even
okay.
even if you have a group in the same department, two different groups in the same department might have a different culture because that's how they.
Yes, definitely. So this is also the case for us. We have some people where there are some people who's training or they learned a lot about it. So they got really really firm on it and do a lot of very good software development. But we have other teams. Where you have nearly nobody and people can just do their scripting a bit, and so it depends. So, and the question we're asking is like, for these people, how can we teach them software engineering, how to get for them? And here again, I want to ask you if you have anything like, do you have a central provided infrastructure, perhaps like a repository and issue tracker, who has something like that in their research?
Yeah.
Okay, most? What's with trainings which are offered by, yeah, like internally, like not with external partners, but like out of the company? Do you have that too?
Mm-hmm.
Not really. Okay, this is something not everybody has. Okay, so what we wanted to do over the last years, or what we did in the last years, and it's also longer than we know the word for RSE. To be honest, we just learned about it kind of last year. But we're kind of doing this for quite a time. We try to bring people to software engineering, and this is what we did with the initiative, which we created, and it consists of different things. So it consists of trainings, but also of a set of guidelines to help people, of knowledge provision, so we provide information about possibilities to collaborate that we create, and it's most important also an experience exchange. And the goal of all of this together is to improve the sustainability and quality of the software product we created, you know. And so everything we do is always around this goal. So we try to make the software better, which is, yeah, kind of, I think, the goal of most of us. And but of this initiative is all these activities, we have one thing which is kind of the backbone, and that's the software engineering network. And this is something we learned is something it's not existing in most other places. So what we have is we have in every institute, we have a representative with somebody who's really interested or really working in software engineering. So at the beginning, it was just one person. So somebody was picked or somebody volunteered. But over time, it shifted to those people who really have the most to do with software engineering. And they are all in one network, which is led by our central software engineering representative, and that's Tobias, who's here with me. So his job is to really take care of all of DLR, of all the people there, and to think about where we can go. And me and my group, or we work together, are helping him with that. And the idea of this network is, on the one hand, to be a possibility of communication, meaning if we want to do something new, or if we have some news, we give it to them and they can distribute it into their institute. They can prepare it in the way they need or can decide if it's important. And the other way around also, so if they have needs in the institute, if they need some central stuff, they can come and talk to us. So the people go then to the representatives in the institutes, which they know, and they can talk to us. But that's not all they do. So it's not just a communication thing. So the task of those contacts is also to organize software engineering activities in their own institute. So to take whatever we take and adapt it, or we come up with their own ideas. So there are groups meeting once a week. So this network means once a year face-to-face, so that we have really a community around there. And we are on call every 3 months. But we learned it's very important to meet really face-to-face, to know the people. And so they started doing this in their institutes, because institutes can range from 40, 50 people up to 200. And then, of course, one person trying to have an overview only about what's happening in this institute, it's already quite a job. Especially since this role is something they do next to their job. It's not, most people don't even have special resources. In some institutes that they have, it really depends on the management.
Really?
Yeah, really. Most people...
Most of the time, it isn't the case.
Exactly. Most of the time, they don't have any extra time, so they have to do this on the side. So you have to have this people included.
I have a short question.
Yes.
Time is not interrupt if you want me to.
No, it's fine. There's so many little people, so we can't do this.
I'm interested. How many... So you have a representative per institution?
Mm-hmm.
We have one, and sometimes like a co-representative. So sometimes it's two. But so yeah, this is why we just changed it a bit. So we have like the official one, because you have one role, which is your official contact. But we introduced in every institute, we can say there's also a software engineering team, and they are taking care of it. This is quite new. We just made that happen in the last weeks. So in every of these institutes, we have like a bunch of people who are interested in software engineering who say they're not like the official person, they don't have this role, but they can be included. And the nice thing is this, before it was, we had to take care about signing up, who's the official contact and stuff, and now it's given to them, so they have the power to say, oh, we signed this person up for the group, or he's dropping out because it was too much work, or whatever. So they can decide how many people and whoever is interested in being in there. And they are also included in the network, so we try to branch it out on the next level. But for us, it's important to have one central contact with which we can talk, and who perhaps then has a team to back him up, or her.
So,
the role of the software engineering contact is is to bring about awareness of software engineering
into
the
institute.
And is it also to monitor if projects are conforming to software engineering best practices, or is it mostly outreach, education?
It depends really on the institute, because on this level of software engineering network, we do not push people too hard, we just give recommendations and things like that. And to be honest, the enforcement of those things really only makes sense in the concrete group that develops a certain piece of software, because only there you know how to map this generic good practice to actual things that you do. Okay.
So the overall society just aims, the overall network is just to bring out awareness.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's more about
it's
awareness and to have a contact, positive contact from up as well as from down. There's the people in the institute now who I can talk to, like the developer knows who I can ask for information. It's not his job to answer everything, but to be able to point them so they know, like, okay, there's this information you have to ask these people. So it's more like a coordination role.
So it's pushing the topic into the institute, or pushing it in the right way, because not every institute is so deep into software development. So it depends really on their research domain and actual tasks that they have to do. So some need more, some need less. So it's
quite. Are all the representative groups active? Or seem a bit quiet?
Most of them, so at the beginning we had a lot of people just listen in, but as I said, they switched to the active person, so this role was handed over. And now we have really, really active community. There's some who are really outstanding, like they organize their teams and they have meetups every 2 weeks or something. So they are really, really active. But most of them at least are like, they do that what we ask for them, like,
at least we
give information in and out, work with us together on projects and information, stuff like that.
We have this face-to-face meetup for 5 years now, and in average we always have 25 participants. And we have about 30 really active, full established institutes right now. We are currently some others are building up. But this is a quite good ratio.
Exactly.
In particular, that you really come to the meetings because we don't force them to do that. So they can get out of something from that, but they're pushed. So and also what they can contribute, and we don't say, oh, you have to do this and that and things like that. But for that reason, I feel it's quite fine, and also during the phone calls, we have a similar number of people joining that. But currently, we have to say it's still our group a little pushing it, but we are now trying, and slowly but surely this happens also, to enable them to contribute a little bit more. So some signs of that I feel are, for instance, that there are small subgroups. So if they are located in one location, then at least we have two subgroups that meet each other on a certain level, and also have some meeting notes and things like that they share with others. They currently take a little bit over the details of open sourcing. We are currently in the process of building up an open source process, a little bit in chase others, and they are a little bit taking this over. So
I think we have to shorten this up now because we're kind of losing our time. Yeah, we have some more stuff to cover. So this is a nice structure which we have, and yeah, we can discuss this later also more. But one example is the one I'm coming next to is what happened in working together with the network, the software engineering guidelines which we created. So the idea of these guidelines which we have is not to have a set of requirements but really recommendations. And the first idea is to give people, the developers, the possibility to get an overview about the current software engineering status of their project. Meaning, on the one hand, it shows them what they can do, but it's also about, okay, where am I at the moment, where I'm starting on. So the focus of all of this is about good practices, because we don't really believe in best practices, because there's no best thing for something as big as DLR in general. It's about tools, it's about essential documentation, again here just about what's really necessary, and we try to focus on that. And so we have this kind of checklist which are on three different maturity levels. So we say it's either you have a project which is just used by another person, then if there's a problem, so you don't have to do all the software engineering. If more people are using it, it's important for your group or for a group of people, then you should take more care, it's more mature, you should take care of your software. And the last stage is really that you have a real product type thing, which is really important for your whole institute or even whole of DLR, and then you should even go further. So we have checklists which are building up on each other, and they are really kept short. So we have a recommendation, we have a status. So you have like a recommendation at the beginning, you should keep all the bugs somewhere, so every time something goes wrong, you should write it down. We don't say where it should happen or something, it's just like, because we don't care if they use a TXT file, if you use Excel or an issue tracker, as long as they do it for the first stage. And they can set a status. They can say, okay, I'm already doing it, they can to do, okay, I want to do this, I have to change this, I have to work on that. They can say, oh, it's future use, this is something I do on a later phase of my project, which makes sense when you, for example, want to have for a project style, but you're not yet there. You can say, okay, we are not doing continuous integration yet because we don't have, or something, because we don't have written our test yet. So this is future. And you can say, no, I'm not doing this. And then you should leave a comment, at least, why you're not doing this. Because it might be that because of some standards or for some reason you're not doing or following something specific. But it's your freedom to do so, because it's just recommendations. But of course, giving such a short recommendation can mean people who are like, okay, why should I do this? Or can you give me a hint how I should do this? And therefore we have further advice. So for every recommendation, if you need to, you can read up to it. And you have like the motivation why you think this is important. And also suggestion how you can solve it as a possible, like, even including a link to, for example, our issue tracker and the how-to or something, like how you could use it. But as I said, it's just a suggestion. And all of these recommendations are also grouped by topics like change management. And if you don't even know why the hell should I have something like change management, there's even a section describing why this is important. So
depending on your knowledge level, you can read up more and more details. And I say always say if you're not happy with the description of a section, then it's like the next step is to go to Wikipedia and read up about the most basic things, why or what something is. But it's like if you already know, if you're into software engineering, you can work with really this information. You can ignore kind of rest. Yes.
Are these both like the forms and descriptions? Do you have them in both German and English?
Exactly. We just so we started in German because we're a German aerospace. And it was easier because we got the network, so the software engineer network, everybody invited them to work with us on. So we got a lot of feedback and a lot of work from them. And so we did it in German first to get rid of understanding and how you formulate a rep. But we translated everything, and we now just got last week the permission to publish it, and we will put all of this online in the next 1 or 2 months, we hope. So we are currently working on it. It's more like the technical stuff and how we name all of this through correctly. But it will be really soon published. We always, for those people who have been at WISPI or RC, we already promised that we wanted to do this. And it took a time, as you see. But especially the translation took some time, because again, we did it in a group effort so that everybody would also understand the translator, that we wouldn't miss something, because on the other hand, it was also not possible to just hire a translator, because they wouldn't understand what it's about and always miss or really often miss a point. So this was a bit of an effort to have all of this in English, but now we have.
Said, that's fantastic, and maybe if you want to write a little item for us, we'd be happy to promote it on Software AC UK.
Yeah, this is really nice.
We also talked with Neil about this,
yeah.
And there was also some progress in putting all the different guidelines together.
Oh,
well,
yeah.
They're already out a lot.
Exactly.
As I presented this last year on the RCE, during the talk came to my mind, okay, this also really depends on the organization that you're focused on, because it depends if you're looking at the large thing or at the tiny thing, you might need something different.
So we have this, and it will be published, and we're using this not only for software engineering guidelines, as guidelines to pan it out, and that's there, but for example, we also offer trainings, and they are based from this year on, because we just published it last year, so it's started with it. The trainings will be focused on the guidelines, so we will have a basic training, which is like, okay, if you're in application class one, like somebody else should use it, you should follow these things, and in this training you learn how which tools you need and how you can do this. So, and how the documentation stuff can look like.
It's a little bit similar to the software carpentry, what you're doing on the basis like
mm-hmm.
with Git, and you will use, hopefully soon, GitLab, which is hosted at ER locally, and as I talked yesterday with someone who did such a class, and you start maybe here with GitHub, but this, I think from the level quite similar, so just a one day shoot up a training in this direction.
Can I ask a really silly question? What sort of format is, when you say publish this, what sort of format are we talking? Are we talking documents and PDF?
For now, it will be on an HTML page, so it's in the back, it's ASCII.doc.
Right.
So that we can create, currently we can create a PDF, oh no, PDF, can we already?
I can show you a few.
Yeah, but we have different formats, so like Markdown and so on. And when we publish it now, for everybody, at the beginning it will be most likely a PDF and a website, but our plan is then to put even the ASCII doc out so that everybody can create whatever they want out of it.
Because we have this background document, which is normally PDF, also for our quality or whatever stuff, and we don't want to copy-paste the checklist, you know?
Yes.
Exactly,
so you can create...
The documentation is code, of course. Yeah.
Excel sheets and whatever people love, you out of wiki form in syntax or whatever, that you can put it in there.
Because then if you have a source, you could import one and generate checklists.
Exactly, this is what we're doing. We have one the source, and you can say, I want to have class 1, class 2, class 3,
and
they get
and also
extracted
for the publication. You know, it's the same source. More
yeah,
less.
We just have some special script which will create the website, which is where we use the framework which supports ASCII.doc. So this, we don't, because we said it's most important that we have everything on one place that we can change. And the idea is even to have it further adaptable, that if somebody forks something or they can have their own. The first edition, if they say, okay, I want to have this also in category 1 or something, or other categories, they can create a definition file where then exactly their set of guidelines is created. So our plan was always to make this more adaptable, because As Tobias said, we are on an organizational level, like, and we have all these institutes, and we already know it will be different for them. So they will have perhaps different versions. And was, but once, if we make this possible for within DLR, we can also make it possible for outside of DLR. So let's go back to the trainings, where we have our tools. So currently the concept is that we have an intensive two-day course where we have like 15 people together with two trainings. We are hands-on example where they play around really once the whole process. As we mentioned, we want to change this to perhaps a one-day course where they get like the basic information. But again, it should be like hands-on, so they should really play around. And with GitLab, currently it's SVN Masters, so a bit outdated, but we're switching to GitLab this year. And the idea is again that people are really doing this hands-on example and also experience problems like conflicts and stuff, and not just in theory, but really experience them, how to solve them, how to handle them. And it's not a big issue, especially with GitLab anymore, or not as big as it used to be. The trainings are offered on a yearly basis in different locations at DLR. So being in all over Germany, the reason is we want people, everybody has an easy way to attend it, so they don't have to travel for something, instead we travel as trainers. And even if there's need for a whole group or something because they start something, we also offer additional topics, additional trainings, or even additional topics. Like we also have trainings about open source, or we do it about with the focus on testing, or different tooling, or different programming languages, and stuff like this. At least as far as we can, because we're just a bunch of people who know just a bunch of languages. If it gets too exotic, we try to find these external partners, external trainers to help them, because we can't do everything. We're just really a handful of people. So, but of course, transporting information about training and knowledge about training is one thing. You just have a bunch of people, sometimes a year, and sometimes people want to read up something, or want to know something very specific. And therefore, we have the software engineering wiki. So we have an internal wiki at DLR, which has the nice feature that you can have real wiki spaces, like sub-wikis. It's a confluence. And so we have the software engineering area where everybody can contribute, and the content is, there's still quite some content from us from the beginning, but everything which is new since the starting set, a lot, is really from other people outside of our group. And we are more about moderating it, about structuring it, and motivating people to write into it. So when we know somebody did something, we go to them and like, oh, don't you want to write something? And this can be a lot of different things. It can be new, so we have other people posting about interesting workshops, about interesting call for papers, not just us. We have information about different topics like architecture, testing, and so on and so on. We have more or less official programming guides where we get some recommendations like for Python, which are based on like how do you format stuff, how should you comment stuff, which is kind of a bit more because it's, yeah, everybody agreed like how should you use it more or less. But we have also like experience exports, so we, or how to's. So we ask people if they played around with the tool for something to write something about it. And the main information is that somebody gets a rough idea what this is done. It doesn't have to be much in detail, but about the person who's behind it. So if somebody's thinking about using this tool, after a brief look, he has a chance to contact somebody and ask, like, okay, what was your experience? I want to use it for this and that. Have you perhaps done something similar? Because writing everything down without knowing somebody else uses is something that people don't tend to do. But if you say, okay, make just some sentences, copy the description of Wikipedia or whatever, but write your name next to it. This helps everybody a lot. And last but not least, we have a Q&A section, which is a bit like a really poor version of Stack Overflow, because it's really just like you create a page with a question and then the comments as the answers, and you can like them, but you don't have a sorting or something. But this works out quite well, and the nice thing is people really go there instead to Stack Overflow, because when they are not sure, if it's something internally specific, like how do I work with the tools we have internally, or if you know, I want to ask a question where I perhaps have to give some information out which I can't publish or something, so inside of DLR, this might work better. And for a lot of questions, you know, okay, this is so related, so specific to one of our researchers, right? So like, there's even not a lot of people out there, it's much likely that I'll find this person in DLR. And the nice thing about this Q&A section is that people start using the wiki. So they start entering a question, they get answers, they get discussions, and then we can write, oh, here, there's so many answers or stuff. Perhaps you can make an experience page or a topic page out of it. And so this happens. So people get looser, there's a fear to add something into a wiki because they start in this Q&A area, which is obviously for collaboration stuff. So this works really well to get people into this wiki. But meeting and collaborating and giving information in a wiki, like not seeing each other, is of course just one part, because as I mentioned, having a community is really important, so that people want to contribute and stuff, and that's why we introduced experience exchange workshops. This is something which exists year-wide, and it's open to all of them. They exist for different topics. But in one of the first years, the software engineering was... To be honest, it didn't... So how it works is you can suggest a topic for an experience workshop, which should exist, or knowledge exchange workshops, they call them. And then everybody can vote. And software engineering won the vote from the public, like from the employees. It was really tough. So it was just 1 or 2% less, more than another topic. But then also the head of the department and stuff are allowed to give their vote in, and they weighed a bit more. And so we made a very, very close second. But the institute who suggested the topic, which was surprising, was not our institute, it was not us, said we want to do it anyway. So instead of knowledge exchange workshops, how the others call it, we call it experience exchange workshop, to don't get in trouble with naming. In the end, they always call us the official name, and how happy we're there. And so we do this once a year, and meet up with the people. So the idea is you have a 1.5-day, so 1.5-day workshop. Again, very intense. It's about knowledge sharing, experience sharing, and especially networking. So people would meet up face-to-face. It's often people who have been active in the wiki or who have been on our trainings, who are part of the software engineering group, they all come there, but it's open to everybody. And it's important thing that everybody get involved. It's not just listening passively.
I'm just wondering, is the agenda to one of those available online?
No, because it's just internally. But I just wanted to say, it looks like often the structure looks like we start with an external partner giving a talk to give a little bit outside view, not just the DLR internally one. And then we often have an interactive session where people can network and meet, where the focus is about getting to know each other. And then we have a lot of talks, often in parallel sessions, where people are talking about experiences, about some cool tools they know, about some problems they have. So kind of like here, but it's like really... and the second day is similar. So we always try to have a big interactive part, which is often 2 hours or something, where people discuss different topics, and it really depends on the main focus. So for example, this year it will be an embedded system. So this is in May, so quite soon. And so we will have talks about this, we will have discussions there. And an important factor is that the people know who else is working on these topics. So they're not just the people from space who perhaps know each other, but also meet the people doing embedded systems in aviation or transportation or in energy.
If you want to use speed blogging or collaborative ideas or anything like that, then UConfy will be available. Make available to other people.
Yeah, currently. So this sounds good, but currently the problem for us is that we're always not allowed to use stuff on external servers or something. We have to run it internally. And also we try to promote, to be honest, the wiki with what we do. So we try to use the wiki again, so that in this workshops people get comfortable using the wiki and know it exists, because still not everybody at DLR knows that it's there.
It's interesting.
But so we try always to get everything together.
It's all morning, it's really
yeah.
A lot of new people always come, so come there and so on. And you missed the important stuff, the social event.
Yes.
Between, this is the most important.
Exactly.
Thing,
right? In the evening, we always have a nice dinner and hanging out. And this is also very important, because people come and talking and they come up with ideas, and there's often, so not regularly, but sometimes there are really groups of people meeting up and starting work based on meeting there. And this year we're doing this for the fifth time, so already since 5 years. We're into this and it's working really well, and people are looking up, and we have a real community who comes there, but we also have always new people coming in. And I think this year, because this topic is a little bit more outside our normal scope, where we had like architecture and testing, but I'm assuming it's more on the edge there, then we'll have a lot of new people. So we even, these posters, we print them more or less in the size that you can see here, but then in a nicer, it looks, you know, nicer. And we put them up in all the locations and stuff so that everybody can see it, because reaching people by mail or something, there's so many mails and stuff, it get lost. But when you put up posters like on the canteens and the break rooms and so we print them and we send them to every institute to put up, and they show up everywhere. So this works really well to reach also the people where you don't have on mailing list or something. And we do this also for another one about open source, and there we had nearly a complete shift of people, and we asked like, where do you know from that? And it was like more than 2/3, nearly 3/4, is that right? Like 75%. I knew from it because of posters we put up. So the only thing for us is always to do it in time to have the call for talks also published over that, so that we get input from everywhere. Yeah, I have to look at the time. So,
yes, the
but we come to the summary and the outlook, so we're getting close. How much time do we have left? Oh, we already have.
For sure.
Okay, really fast. Summary and outlook. This all initiative is helping to create a software engineering community at DLR. So this community is a big thing. It was really important for us to have this core community, this network. This helped us a lot. The guidelines is a really nice result. We, with all the stuff we did, because everybody's seeing this, we have a nice management support. We really got to an awareness level there. And yes, we still have stuff to do, like get these guidelines out and get a new version and get it better community. We want to start inner source, which is like open source, but it was in the organization. And very last session, what we learned is you need to, if you want to do something, the first thing is you need to wait to talk to your community to get input, because you have to learn what they need. And that's like really the agile concept. You have to stay agile. You have to learn from them what they need and adapt to that. Not stick with your plan, but listen to them. And all the parts work together. So every single aspect was also interestingly, but combining all of them. And this what did the trick, and you're never done. There's still a lot of stuff to do. Twice I wanted to discuss, so we can do this another time. You just find this, because we're especially interesting if you have ideas for further possible activities which we could do, and how this stuff could be used by you, what you would need for information from us, because we not want to only publish our guidelines, but also like the whole concept behind this, like how we're doing this, and want others to repeat and learn from their experiences. And now we're over. It's just 1 minute. And thank you very much.
It's very sad that we ran out of time.
Yeah.
We should meet up if we can.
Yes. I don't know. Is there another coffee break?
Okay. I don't. I see a coffee.
There's another set now and then.
Yeah. Then there's a coffee break. Yeah. So we'll be in the room in the coffee break. So.
You won't share up?
Yeah.
There's another session
here, but I don't know who it is.
I don't think there's a coffee.
There's no long.
There's no room.
We can also go over there.
There's a panel. I have to be at the panel because I'm part of it.